Welcome back to my fourth video regarding the topic of Flat Earth, the Bible, and the Spirit of Prophecy. After more research and prayer and talking to many people, I felt it was needed to add a little more substantial, irrefutable information regarding the approach we as a church are to take when approaching New Light. So let's briefly continue the discussion of Ellen G. White and her relation to New Light and Flat Earth in order to completely and totally solidify this concept once and for all. We will be looking at a clear historical example of how Ellen White and the church were both in error, and that the Bible was used to correct them, which has always been the SDA motto. Just because we are finding forgotten biblical doctrines today that socially and culturally test us does not mean we should change our stance on biblical authority. On the contrary, it is in times of thick, epic cultural deception that people need to hear the straight, pure words of the Bible. Today we are going to let Ellen White explain this clearly herself, and we will get to the bottom of how to relate to Ellen White and Flat Earth. It is actually quite straightforward, as you will see from this newly organized information. In my last video, part 3, we looked at the clarity with which Ellen White told us she had no light on the topic of round or flat earth. Notice in all of these statements, she mentions both round and flat. She had no light on either model. Notice in the middle of the top paragraph there, she says in 21 Manuscripts 4:14, "When Christ gave my commission to do the work that he placed upon me, the flat or round world was not included in the message." No matter what Ellen White's personal feelings were on the flat or round world, she made it very clear that her work, her commission, and her message did not involve this topic. Friends, this statement clears up all misconceptions and misunderstandings when it comes to Ellen White and her relation to this topic. But don't worry, for we will thoroughly substantiate this point as we continue through our study. But notice before we move on, the middle of the middle paragraph there, the subject of whether the world is round or flat, "Christ had not commanded me anything of the kind. He had not given me any of that work to do." There was a work to do in it. It was not given to Ellen White. And in Manuscripts 155, "I had one come up to me and want to give me information about a round or flat world. Said I have no such burden on my soul at all. I, Ellen White, have nothing to say to you or to anybody else about a round or a flat world." Friends, she's very clear. Now, if we're going to be logical thinkers, we cannot ignore the fact that these statements admitting she has no light on the round or flat world clearly show us that both Ellen G. White and the church will always need the Bible to be their guide. And this especially goes for topics that Ellen White fully and completely admits she had no special insight on. One thing that Ellen White was not aware of is that God actually gave her more insight on this topic than she even knew. I will be showing this to everyone in the near future in a video where we will review her first-hand vision accounts of heaven and of the end of the world. What many SDAs don't realize is that Ellen White's honesty on this matter of round or flat earth is one of the strongest proofs that she is a true messenger from God. In a future video, we will see that none of her first-hand vision accounts have any heliocentric aspects in them. Joseph Bates was the one who said Ellen White went to other planets. It was not Ellen White who said that. Also, the fact, when directly asked, Ellen White said she did not know the answer to round or flat earth, even after being to heaven in vision multiple times. The logical implications of that fact cannot be ignored. This shows she is a honest and true messenger, for even when the church was going with the world in believing the false and unbiblical model of earth, she still was honest about the light she had or did not have on the topic. She very easily could have put this argument to rest by saying, "It's round, I've seen it from heaven multiple times." But thank God she didn't let the church fully influence her in the wrong direction on a topic she had no light on. She at least stayed neutral. SDAs don't realize that if Ellen White had said, "The earth is a globe for sure because I have seen it," it would have been a much bigger problem for her as a true messenger, due to the clear biblical discrepancies that say otherwise. At least in her ignorance, she remained neutral when asked directly if the earth was round or flat, rather than fully following the way the church was going. The bottom line is, it doesn't matter what anyone says, it only matters what the Bible says. And Ellen White 100% agrees with this principle, for she says, "If the testimonies speak not according to the word of God, reject them." The only way around the logic of that statement is pure denial of what she is clearly saying. Ellen White could not get more clear in that statement that the Bible always comes first. And today, we're going to look at a perfectly clear example of how the Bible and Ellen White work. We're going to see how Ellen White was wrong and the Bible corrected her. This logical sequence of authority will never change, even if it is a long process sometimes. It was the same in Ellen White's day when the Bible corrected them, and it's the same today. The Bible is still here to correct and guide us, so let's let it do its job. The real question is, are we as Adventists going to follow through with the claim of sola scriptura? I pray the Adventist Church stays true to that claim. All right, we're going to continue moving on through the study. But don't forget to watch the video on Ellen White's first-hand vision accounts when it's done. You won't want to miss it. Let's move forward and dive a little deeper now. Let's consider the topic of biblical authority and its relation to the church, as well as Ellen White's own theological path of growth. Here is a great opening statement that outlines our study today and is exactly what we as SDAs always need to remember when studying topics. Ellen G. White herself clearly tells us that the testimonies of Sister White should not be carried to the front. God's Word is the unerring standard. Very clear there, friends. The testimonies are not to take the place of the Word. Great care should be exercised by all believers to advance these questions carefully. Let all prove their positions from Scripture and substantiate every point they claim as truth from the revealed Word of God. Friends, that is clear. She said that statement for a very important logical reason. It's a reason that we are going to see infinitely matters today, right now, in these last days. Growing up as a fourth-generation Seventh-day Adventist, I was saturated in Seventh-day Adventist culture. I traveled to many events, I went to camp meetings, and later I went to Seventh-day Adventist Evangelism School. I've had many years and many opportunities to see and learn from SDA culture, including the culture of misusing and or ignoring specific Ellen White statements while also ignoring what the Bible says in an attempt to sustain a particular opinion. I understand that mindset, as I've been guilty of it before, too. Still, today, multiple topics can supposedly be either proven or disproven, both ways in the spirit of prophecy, depending on who you talk to. But this is because one or multiple sides will use small portions or spliced up Ellen White statements as their source material, which naturally will force them to have to hold it above what the Bible says. This only causes confusion, which is precisely why Ellen White said to never do it. Our position and faith is in the Bible, and never do we want any soul to bring in the testimonies ahead of the Bible. Thank you, Ellen, for that clarity. Now, like we've seen already and are going to continue to see throughout this study, Ellen White clearly conveyed that even though God gave her authoritative insight on many issues, it does not mean she was infallible on every topic, for she too was on a path of theological learning, as we will see an example of shortly. But most importantly, she taught that the Bible always has the final say. Ellen White tried to remind us of this ongoing, sometimes long process, as we will continue to read and see. We will also see that she clearly states more light will be coming, and that the Bible is the standard by which we are to test all information, whether the information is new or old. This entire topic and concept of biblical authority and how it relates to the church and Ellen White is 100% founded on understanding the logical foundation of what distinguishes truth and error. And it is surprisingly simple and logical. As stated in the Great Controversy, the Bible and the Bible only is the standard for all doctrines and the basis for all reforms. Now, have you ever stopped to think deeply and logically about the concept of truth versus error and its relation to the Bible and reality? Have you ever wondered how much truth versus error our church has taught and advocated over the years? These are important questions with profound implications that affect millions of souls. Friends, it is good for us to learn the importance of distinguishing truth from error. Notice Ellen White confirms what the true soul bond of unity is. The Bible and the Bible alone is to be our creed, the soul bond of union. All who bow to this holy word will be in harmony. Man is fallible, God's word is infallible. In other words, if Seventh-day Adventists actually practiced giving the final authority to the Bible only, we would all be in harmony. Now notice what she says about error. Here's a statement from 5T292. Says, error is never harmless. It never sanctifies, but always brings confusion and dissension. Which, my friends, is exactly what the unbiblical heliocentered model does. It leads people away from the original biblical truth, which, as we can clearly see, only causes dissension. Flat Earth biblical cosmology, like any other easily biblically established doctrine, is not causing dissension. It is the truth attempting to unite us. Error is the real cause of dissension. The heliocentric model is the actual, unbiblical error that is causing all of the unbelief and dissension. How do we easily know this? Because heliocentrism is found nowhere in the Bible. Ellen White continues in 5T292 saying, "Error is always dangerous. The enemy has great power over minds that are not thoroughly fortified and established in Bible truth." Friends, the whole great controversy is based on the battle between truth and error. That's how important it is. Along the church's path through time, we are told that light would continue shining ever increasingly brighter from God's word. We are told that our errors and scriptural misapplications would be revealed more clearly through faithful Bible study, for truth never stops advancing. We are reminded of this from a statement in the Review and Herald, March 25, 1890. We must not think, "Well, we have all the truth, we understand the main pillars of our faith, and we may rest on this knowledge." The truth is an advancing truth, and we must walk in the increasing light. And here's another statement. Whenever the people of God are growing in grace, they will be constantly obtaining a clearer understanding of His Word. They will discern new light and beauty in its sacred truths. This has been true in the history of the church in all ages, and thus it will continue to the end. But as real spiritual life declines, it has ever been the tendency to cease to advance in the knowledge of the truth. Men rest satisfied with the light already received from God's Word, and they discourage any further investigation of the Scriptures. They become conservative and seek to avoid discussion. When no new questions are started by investigation of the Scriptures, when no difference of opinion arises to cause men to search the Bible for themselves, there will be many now who will hold to tradition and worship what they know not. Friends, this principle is very serious to understand. Inspiration tells us that this constant growth in truth will at times inevitably require us to give up long-held views and opinions along the way. Notice what is said in this next statement. How shall we search the Scriptures? Shall we drive our stakes of doctrine one after another and then try to make all Scripture meet our established opinions? Or shall we take our ideas and views to the Scriptures and measure our theories on every side by the Scriptures of truth? Many who read and even teach the Bible do not comprehend the precious truth they are teaching or studying. Men entertain errors when the truth is clearly marked out, and if they would but bring their doctrines to the Word of God and not read the Word of God in light of their doctrines to prove their ideas right, they would not sit in darkness and blindness or cherish error. Many give the words of Scripture a meaning that suits their own opinions, and they mislead themselves and deceive others by their misinterpretations of God's Word. As we take up the study of God's Word, we should do so with humble hearts. All selfishness, all love originality should be laid aside. Long-cherished opinions must not be regarded as infallible. It was the unwillingness of the Jews to give up their long-established traditions that proved their ruin. They were determined not to see any flaw in their own opinions or in their expositions of the Scriptures. But however long men may have entertained certain views, if they are not clearly sustained by the written word, they should be discarded. Let's read that sentence one more time. If they are not clearly sustained by the written word, they should be discarded. We have many lessons to learn and many, many to unlearn. God and heaven alone are infallible. Those who think they will never have to give up a cherished view, never have an occasion to change an opinion, will be disappointed. As long as we hold to our own ideas and opinions with determined persistency, we cannot have the unity for which Christ prayed. Review and Herald, July 26, 1892. My friends, that statement is powerful, clear, and direct. We as individuals and as a church are to change our opinions according to God's word only, rather than trying to twist information to fit our own opinions. Notice Ellen White said that the church, including her, had many lessons to learn and many, many to unlearn. The Bible, on the other hand, has nothing to learn or unlearn. Ellen White understood that she and the church had to go through a process of biblical growth, which we will see a historical example of in just a few minutes. Now, this ability to learn from the Bible in order to change one's own opinion based on biblical information, Ellen White calls keeping pace with the light. I pray all SDAs will strive to keep pace with the light by researching the scriptures. Now let's switch gears and look a little bit closer at how the principle of light and truth relates to us as a church. James White, one of our SDA founders, touched on this topic years ago. He too wondered how much truth or error the church was teaching in an article he wrote some years after the SDA church had formed. Here's a portion taken from the Adventist Review and Sabbath Herald, 1856. Many are the false steps that we as a people have taken. And why is it? Because we have been following other teachers and departing from the simple teachings of the Word. Are there not now many of us advocating theories that are not taught in the Bible? Yes, theories which are contrary to sound doctrine. See with what tenacity we advocated 6 o'clock as the time to commence the day. Was it because the Bible taught it? And are we not advocating other theories which are as contrary to the light of lamp as that was? I fear so. Some of the brethren are, I fear, walking in paths which are not lighted by the lamp of truth. James was aware of this ongoing battle between truth and error. Notice James brought to memory the fact that the church, including Ellen G. White, tenaciously kept and taught Sabbath commencement erroneously for many years, actually. It took some Bible digging before they found the clarifying biblical information that was there the whole time, and ended up taking many years for the church to let go of just this one previously tenaciously defended opinion. It does not have to take that long to let go of error. It is up to us and how much we search and listen to our Bible. In any case, James in his article was confirming the importance of allowing God's Word to be the final authority on every question so that we don't end up wasting precious time fiddling with error. This is a paramount and fundamental principle to understand in order to efficiently keep pace with the light. James' logic in his article was spot on, but God also gave the church through Ellen White, James's wife, an even more unique and special experience for us to learn from regarding this principle of keeping pace with the light. Like mentioned earlier, our SDA founders, including Ellen White, tenaciously taught the wrong time of Sabbath commencement before people in the church started raising questions about how they did not think it was biblical, which is actually an instance where the church body did its job and influenced Ellen White and the leaders the right way to get to a biblical conclusion. So Jay Andrews decided to thoroughly study out the topic, and he correctly used the Bible to conclude and publish that it was sunset to sunset based on the clear Bible verses he had found during his research. It was after this finding of the Bible truth on the Sabbath commencement that God sent an angel to Ellen in order to very clearly drive home the importance of this most vital lesson of using the Bible as our guide for all doctrinal questions that will arise. This was the single most important lesson the church needed and still needs to learn, which makes sense why God sent an angel to personally confirm it. Notice what the angel said to Ellen. Said the angel, "Take the word of God, read it, understand, and ye cannot err." I asked the angel if the frown of God had been upon his people for commencing the Sabbath as they had. Said the angel, "If light comes, and that light is set aside or rejected, then comes the condemnation and the frown of God. But before the light comes, there is no sin, for there is no light for them to reject." Testimonies, Volume 1, 116. Discussing straightforward truths with an angel from God would be a most awesome and important experience for any human to have. The lesson of letting biblical authority define truth and doctrine was so important for the church to learn that God chose to send an angel to authoritatively and clearly drive home this principle of biblical authority. When examined, we can see how important this concept is to God through this angelic conversation. The first and most paramount principle that we need to notice and learn from the angel's instruction is that the Bible was and is the final source of all truth and light. It was not the angel that determined truth. It was not the church that determined truth. It was not Ellen White and her stance that determined truth. Rather, the angel confirmed it is the Bible alone that determines and defines the truth we are to follow, as well as the error we are to avoid. So after the studying was all said and done, Ellen White and the church leaders finally conceded to the Bible after 10 years of Sabbath commencement error. If the church wants to stay in the truth, it would do well to always remember that the Word of God is infallible. Now, if Ellen White believed the Bible was infallible, did she also consider herself infallible? So let's go take a look at what she says. In regard to infallibility, I never claimed it. God alone is infallible. His Word is true, and in Him is no variableness or shadow of turning. She continues to drive this home in another book, The Great Controversy Introduction. Says, the Spirit was not given, nor can it ever be bestowed, to supersede the Bible. For the Scriptures explicitly state that the Word of God is the standard by which all teaching and experience must be tested. Isaiah declares, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. That last statement goes right along with the statement that we opened our study with. She says, the testimonies of Sister White should not be carried to the front. The next sentence explains why we are not to carry her writings to the front. It is because God's Word is the unerring standard. The testimonies are not to take the place of the Word. Great care should be exercised by all believers to advance these questions carefully. Let all prove their positions from Scripture and substantiate every point they claim as truth from the revealed Word of God. Friends, how much of a stronger statement is needed? She can't really get much more transparent than that. But let's continue letting her drive this home. She says in another place, our position and faith is in the Bible, and never do we want any soul to bring in the testimonies ahead of the Bible. Notice she says to never bring them ahead of the Bible. Friends, this is a very clearly spelled out and most important principle being taught here by Ellen White. Ellen White's counsel was given to the church not to determine truth and doctrine, but to point the church back to the source that does determine truth and doctrine, which is the Bible, which she clearly says is the standard for all doctrine and all reform. She clarifies this in the chapter, The Scriptures Are Safeguard, in the book, The Great Controversy. But God will have a people upon the earth to maintain the Bible and the Bible only as the standard of all doctrines and the basis for all reforms. The opinions of learned men, the deductions of science, the creeds or decisions of ecclesiastical councils, not one nor all of these should be regarded as evidence for or against any point of religious faith. Before accepting any doctrine or precept, we should demand a plain, thus saith the Lord, in its support. If men would but take the Bible as it reads, a work would be accomplished that would bring into the fold of God thousands upon thousands who are now wandering in error. As we can see, she is very straightforward about this concept. That statement we just read falls right in line with the counsel from the angel and the scenario of the church and Ellen White erroneously teaching the commencement of the Sabbath for many years, until Bible truth was seen and understood. The scenario with the angel and the Sabbath commencement error is an unarguable, real-life example of Ellen White's and the church's fallibility versus the Bible's infallibility. Ellen White's writings have been invaluable for helping authoritatively clarify and point us back to much biblical truth. But like she so clearly said, her and all of us, the church, have many things to learn and many, many things to unlearn. And it is written is the standard by which everyone, including Ellen White, will be tested. We have grand, solemn truths for the people. It is written is the test that must be brought home to every soul. Gospel Workers 3:09. Now I know some will try to argue that error and truth are not important and that we should just focus on love. That mindset sounds easier, but it is not logical or biblical, for if it were so, then Jesus and all the Bible writers wouldn't have worried about very clearly telling people who chose to love God to obey the truth of His commands. Biblically speaking, trying to separate the concepts of truth and love even one iota is paradoxical, as you can't have the true fulfillment of love without the truth as its foundation. Now, to the SDA Church, truth is a foundational concept, which it has prided itself in claiming to believe and understand. Yet many SDAs forget that in that book they claim to know and believe, it warns us that pride comes before a fall, which was demonstrated many times by the Old Testament Church, or the Jews. We were warned that the present-day Church can and will make the same mistakes if we are not careful. The spirit of the Pharisees has been coming in upon the people who claim to believe the truth for these last days. They are self-satisfied. They have said, "We have the truth. There is no more light for the people of God." But we are not safe when we take the position that we will not accept anything else than that upon which we have settled as truth. We should take the Bible and investigate it closely for ourselves. We should dig in the mine of God's Word for truth. Review and Herald, June 18, 1888. Friends, the Jews made the mistake of not moving forward with biblical light. They decided to listen to man's ideas and the culture around them instead of listening to the very clear words from Scripture. Their pride blinded them to the truth right in front of them. The false emotion that told them they were right is the same emotion you and I feel when we think we are right about something. This is why mankind needs the Bible as our guide so badly. The Jews ignored the truth because they thought they already knew it. They thought they were already blessed with all the light from God, when in reality they were blind and naked and needed to re-examine the Scriptures. Too often this is repeated today in our denomination. Instead of using the Bible to grow in truth and studying it to keep pace with the light, some will instead stand by the old landmarks of our founders when there is still much truth and light to add to the framework of the gospel and still much error to carve away from it. Ellen White warned this would be happening more at the end of time. Notice what she says in this next comment. There are men among us who profess to understand the truth for these last days, but who will not calmly investigate advanced truth. They are determined to make no advance beyond the stakes which they have set, and will not listen to those who, they say, do not stand by the old landmarks. They consider it a virtue to be at variance with their brethren, and they close the door, that light shall not find an entrance to the people of God. It will require heavenly wisdom to know how to deal with such cases. Light will come to God's people, and those who have sought to close the door will either repent or be removed out of the way. The time has come when a new impetus must be given to the work. There are terrible scenes before us, and Satan is seeking to keep from our knowledge the very things that God would have us to know. God has messengers and messages for his people. If ideas are presented that differ in some points from our former doctrines, we must not condemn them without diligent search of the Bible to see if they are true. We must fast and pray and search the Scriptures, as did the noble Bereans, to see if these things are so. We must accept every ray of light that comes to us. Through earnest prayer and diligent study of God's Word, dark things will be made plain to the understanding. Signed to the Times, May 26, 1890. Friends, I could not have said it better. There is much truth to be found in God's Word. There is much we need to re-examine as individuals, and as a church. There is no excuse for anyone in taking the position that there is no more truth to be revealed, and that all our expositions of Scriptures are without error. The fact that certain doctrines have been held as truth for many years by our people is not a proof that our ideas are infallible. Age will not make an error into truth, and truth can afford to be fair. No true doctrine will lose anything by close investigation. Review and Herald, December 20, 1892. How many SDAs read that and actually understand it? We need to investigate and learn every detail in God's Word because He put them in there for a reason. There are mines of truth yet to be discovered. We have only the glimmerings of the rays of the light yet to come to us. There are old yet new truths still to be added to the treasures of our knowledge. There are bright and important truths of which we only discern the shadows. Gems of thought are to be gathered up and redeemed from their companionship with error, for by their misplacement in the association of error, the author of truth has been dishonored. The precious gems of the righteousness of Christ and truths of divine origin are to be carefully searched out and placed in their proper setting, to shine with heavenly brilliancy amid the moral darkness of the world. Let the bright jewels of truth, which God gave to man, be carefully rescued from the rubbish of error. Let the gems of divine light be reset in the framework of the gospel. Let nothing be lost of the precious light that comes from the throne of God. It is heaven sent, and each gem is to become the property of God's people and find its true position in the framework of truth. Friends, the Bible is full of knowledge and truth that is now spilling out, so that people like myself, who were lost in error, can come to the knowledge of the truth and begin correctly navigating this reality. Friends, the Bible will always be the final authority and guide for the SDA Church and Ellen White. It is a guide for you and I in all places and in all times. The answers to all our questions about life and doctrines are in God's Word. If you want to know what your destiny is, if you want to know what your true value is, if you want to know what reality is, if you want to know what this earth really is, if you want to know your beginnings as well as your future, if you want to know what is happening now and what is going to happen soon, if you don't want to be deceived, and if you want to know the absolute truth in any category of life, then research your Bible while asking God to help you, and He will do it. Thank you for listening, and God bless.